All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are just about to start the expert panel meeting. We are not being streamed on Facebook because Jared is not here. Oh, here he is coming now. So as all of the experts, and Paddy Waldron, can you join us here at the top as well? So as all the experts take their seats, I will introduce them, and then we will get on with a very quick 15-minute expert panel discussion. And Jared will, once you've started recording, then you could join us, Jared, yes. So we have 15 minutes, and then we're all going to be kicked out of here at 5 o'clock in the evening. So, it gives me great pleasure to introduce, from the right, James Irvin, Donna Rutherford, Michelle Leonard, Catherine Borges, Brad Larkin, Paddy Waldron, and soon to join us, Jared Corkin. Can you please give our experts a round of applause? And the ever late Debbie Kent. So you're all very, very welcome to the panel. We are blessed to have the creme de la creme, rich and thick, of genetic genealogists. So we'll kick off with a couple of questions from the audience. Who has a question for the experts? Thank you all very much for coming today. Here we have a question at the front.
Reference was made to SNP test packs. What are they and who supplies them?
I'll start it off. SNP packs are a product from Family Tree DNA that they've started to do Sanger sequencing on groups of markers that have been previously identified as being all part of the same branch of, say, the Y. So where the big Y tests a whole bunch of markers, but it doesn't always resolve every single one. It's next-gen sequencing, it's a different technology. When they do SNP packs, they do about 100 to 120 SNPs at a time. They predefine it, and it's done with Sanger sequencing, so the resolution of it is very high. But they have to study in advance to know which markers to do. So if you're trying to find a new marker that's not on there, you're not likely to find it in an SNP pack for now. In 10 years, when they get all this figured out, all this tree stuff figured out, there'll be a product that has that. Right now, they're still working their way down the tree. That's my answer.
John?
James? Did you want to add anything?
Well, John has a question here.
He might want to
echo everything Brad said, of course, but I do. YSEC manufacture produce the same thing, and they call it a Y panel. It's a bit confusing. They're very almost identical, I think. And the other thing is that you can't discover new SNPs with a pack test or a panel test, but you can discover their existence. Because if you do the panel test and find you come up, in my case, with L55 plus, but it doesn't come up with plus any sons of L555, I know I've got another son there, but I don't know what its name is. And this has proved very valuable. It was a completely unexpected dimension that you would have thought that there was nothing there, you didn't learn anything. But we discovered the existence of quite a few sons of L55. We don't know who they are. We don't have a name, we don't have anything. We just know they're there because everything else has proved negative.
Okay. The terminology. You know, L155, it's a mess, isn't it? Because as I understand it, it's different companies finding, or different researchers finding the particular SNP, and then it's numbered sequentially, is it? Is there no way in which it could be made more comprehensible to the average genealogist?
Who wants to make that?
That's a difficult one. Debbie gets it.
Catherine. I know part of the answer, but Debbie might be able to elaborate on more. So I know in the beginning when they first started naming SNPs, almost five. That the words came from, like, say, the S series SNP, the S stood for Scotland, and the P series, I've been told this by geneticists, because I don't even know if it's written down anywhere. I was told the P's came from the word polymorphism, and so on and so forth. So it was kind of the way it came about was the person who discovered the SNP got the naming rights to the nomenclature. The L series SNPs that Family Tree DNA has on their tree, L came from Leo Little because he was the first one to find a unique SNP, so they named the L series after him. So there's no standardization, and there really hasn't been. It's kind of based on the level of discovery, who discovers it, what lab, they just take meaning rights to it. It's the best way I can explain it, but that's what I've heard about it. I don't know that it could ever be standardized.
Yeah. Debbie?
Yes, there's also a problem of competing naming systems. So, for instance, Wyeth at one time were renaming every single SNP with their own abbreviation, which I think is YF, correct me. FGC, they also were trying to name SNPs as well. So everyone was trying to get their initials on a SNP. And also the question of what is a SNP is another problem. When do you decide whether a SNP is actually worthy enough to go on the tree? And some people, like FGC, I think will call more detailed SNPs than will call something a SNP which Family Tree DNA won't. Family Tree DNA set much higher criteria for it. But there isn't really an overall body that is in charge of this. And you have to remember, if you go back to the late 1990s, when people first started doing Y chromosome testing, they thought there was hardly any variation in the Y chromosome. They didn't think it was actually going to be very genealogically useful at all. Now, when we first started out, we only had a handful of SNPs. No one ever dreamed that we would suddenly be having what we now call this SNP tsunami. So I think we're still in a state of discovery. I think once the discovery is over and we know all the full sequence of SNPs on the tree, we may possibly get a bit further in standardisation. It's the forensic community, the only ones who try to standardise it, have to be at the very high levels of the tree. And they've got, there's a tree called PhyloTree, the PhyloTree Y tree, and they've selected the preferred names from the literature. So if you get a name in a paper, that is supposed to be the preferred usage. But it's not always followed. So they use something else for L21, I think, that they use, and whereas in genetic genealogy, L21 we ignore the forensic tree. So there isn't really an easy answer at the moment.
James Earl.
I think we've got to stop wasting energy on this point. It's a good, very legitimate question, very legitimate. It's an awful burden we're going to have to bear forever. But there is a solution, I think this is the important thing. Wybrowse, Thomas Kahn's Wybrowse site, wybrowse.org, has all the synonyms listed under the position. Unfortunately, he's got the new positions now, he's lost the old positions, but we can live with that. But most of these synonyms are listed there, and if there's a solution, why worry about the problem?
Brad Larkin.
Thank you. So, one thing is the names versus what they are. What the mutations actually can be identified by is the chromosome, like Y, and then the position on the chromosome according to the scientists that make the full genome. So actually it would be Y and then like position 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then the position numbers change in generations of the reference DNA being regenerated. So right now companies are using the 38th version. So the best way to be consistent is to go the chromosome and the position and then the version number. So we have a tool on genetichomeland.com. It's a free tool. You don't have to even have an account, called the DNA Marker Index. And we've tried to roll up all these different nomenclatures and express them as both the HG38 position and also the HG19 position for Y. And we have over 129,000 now. So I think we use what Thomas does, we use what Family Tree DNA does, and we're right up there with Roland Mall. I think at this point we're as good as anybody because we did a lot of work on it in the last 3 months. So if you Google an obscure marker, you'll typically find the genetic homeland DNA marker index. But that will show you all the different names that are used by different companies and the chromosome and the position in the two
references. comment from the Jerry Corbyn.
The best tree I've seen so far is Alex Williamson's Big Tree, which is very visual. Anyone can understand it. It includes the names and this different interpretations of names, but also links it to surnames and it and cluster groupings, and it gives regional names associated with that. So it's very, very clear. The wife full people, they do an automated process, okay, which standardizes the convention to a certain degree. It also gives ages for each of the SNPs. And I think eventually, as we get into the way into the SNP tsunami, and there are just too many to handle, this process should be automated. Maybe it'll be artificial intelligence, you know, which names them, get humans out of the story, because that just confuses them.
Spoken like a genealogist. No, I think that's absolutely right, and I would only add that I think that the Big Tree is probably my favorite one, because it is visually appealing and because it has surnames at the end of every single branch. It also gives some idea of the country of origin, the place of origin of these surnames, which is also very, very helpful. I would like to see my optimal tree would be something like the Big Tree, but with the branching points dated. So we actually have dates for each of those branching points. So that would be kind of bringing in what WIFL does, but also the Big Tree is only dealing with next generation sequencing tests like the Big Y. It doesn't deal with a lot of the other tests that are out there, like the SNP-PACK tests that you can get from Family Tree DNA. It'd be great if they could be incorporated into the Big Tree as well. And even if you could get close SCR cousins put in there as well, that would be quite useful. And that way you'd get a much more comprehensive tree, lovely visual effect and dating for each of the branches. Debbie Kennett.
Just to comment on that, that will be coming, because Alex Williamson is working with Ian McDonald, who's done a lot of work on U106 with his age analysis, and they are trying to incorporate something now, but of course it's all held up because there's no band files and they're not going to be released until April. But they're going to incorporate the age analysis in that, which Ian's been doing, and link together U106 and P312, and also they're going to try and accommodate FGC and Y-seq chromosome sequencing tests as well. So that is supposed to be coming, but I don't know when. There's a whole group of them working on that.
SNP packs, will they be included?
I don't think SNP packs, no.
See, that's where I'd like SNP packs to be included, because there's a lot of information in SNP packs.
And there's still also all the other haplogroups which aren't included, if you're not an R.
That's right, absolutely. And we should also be including data from the haplogroup projects, because a lot of the branches that are predicted by these unique STR patterns that people see in the haplogroup projects are then turning out, following SNP analysis, to be present. So they are being established, and a lot of that unique STR pattern data should be included as well. Experimentally, provisionally, you know, with a question mark beside it or some kind of like pink circle around it to say don't take this as gospel, you know, but it would be nice to have that as well to get that kind of comprehensiveness.
And we have got the extra markers coming from the Big Y test, haven't we, at some point? I don't remember.
They're coming all the time. Okay. They're coming all the time because I've been adding them to my index.
Where are you getting them from?
I started with kind of what Alex had, and Alex started with a real good set under P312. But then I'm looking at project member results and using the chromosome browser. I've also gotten direct submissions of data lists from like ftDNA also. So I try to use big data lists and do this in database. But then I'm also finding some that are new that I get from the chromosome browser that will give you the position and the mutation. So
is it going to be VCF files, is it, and getting the STRs from that, like WIFL do?
No, I'm more looking at a project member. I'm doing it by hand in this case, but I'm looking at project member results, and then they're getting classified with new SNPs. Like there's new BY numbers all the time. So I go in and look up, okay, that's BY123. Do I have that in my index? No, I don't. Okay, then I go into the chromosome browser, and it will show me the position of the mutation. Then I add it to my index.
No, I'm talking about the people who took the Big Y before Christmas, and they were all going to get the free upgrade to 111 markers.
They don't have, you're talking about STR markers?
Yeah, and also
they've not rolled that out
yet.
They're
going to get the extra markers going back to the 500 from the Big Y test.
That I thought was coming in the spring. I haven't seen that.
No, that's what I was wondering about.
Just this is going to be over the heads, I'm afraid, of 90% of us, let alone you. I have been watching my 25 big Y results with my project members, and there's a drip, drip, drip going on. Every time I look at them, across 25, when, you look at 25, it's a couple of new SNPs appear. Every week or so. And it's being done manually, it's not being done automatically. I read on something just this week, some of the initial upgrading still hasn't been completed. The SNP stuff, the big Y, hasn't been upgraded yet. So it's very much work in progress. And I also had discussions with Mike Sanger, email discussions.
Mike Sanger.
That some of these new ones that are appearing, they're unnamed, but they're just appearing out of the blue. Some of them are named, but they haven't been recognized as named, and some of them are duplicated. And even though they're called high confidence, I think when we get the mandate, they're going to be low confidence. So there's a huge gray area. But this is all at the fringe. It's not knocking the existing happy trees. It's down to a very low level priority. It's low priority. And I think we're going to be living with a mess for some considerable time, at least until we get the BAM data and can work out for ourselves with a lot of effort and teaming what's solid, what isn't, and how we handle it. And this in turn means that we can't start aging these SNPs with a degree of reliability, because if anything's changing, all the ratios, 136 years per SNP, has got to be changed as well. So it's a very evolving subject. But it's at the margin. It's not affected. The basic stuff of big wire and SNPs is, as Brad said, it's blue chip compared with SDRs.
I think you're absolutely right, and I think the key word there is we are evolving. That is the key message. We are evolving. So when you come back next year, you know, some of us won't look like Neanderthals anymore. We'll actually look like we're standing more erect than we were last year. So that's the key take-home message. Any questions?
I have a quickie that I couldn't get out of on. R2-D2, is he going to get a genetic signature?
Time will tell. You have to watch the next in the movie. Let me come down here to a question from the audience.
Just very quickly, I'm wondering, some very ancient civilizations, now I'm just an ordinary person, but I'm thinking, do you remember, I watched a brilliant program on Lucy. Yeah. Now I've watched lots of YouTube stuff on the Egyptians, etc. And there are other cultures. Has DNA discovered the human part of the human and a something else, a missing link? I'm just wondering.
Very, very, very good question. And that ties in very nicely with some recent newspaper reports as well, because one of the early humans that we found here it was over in Britain, was Cheddar Man, of course. Did people see that in the newspapers? Yeah, dark skinned, blue eyes. So, Cheddar, would you like to start off answering this question?
Well, first of all, the idea of the missing link is wrong, because that is not how evolution works. We didn't start out as apes and then gradually, you know, work up onto 2 feet and then become Neanderthals and then become humans. What happened is that we share a common ancestor with primates from something like 8 million years ago, and then different branches developed, and each branch evolved independently. So it's not a progression, there's no missing link to find. What we're looking at is that we're sort of coalescing different branches, and then they all link up thousands or millions of years ago.
What about Neanderthals and other hominids?
So Neanderthals are on a different branch of the human family tree. In fact, I was at an ancient DNA conference last weekend, and Chris Stringer, who's working on the Cheddar Man project, was talking about this concept of species, which is an ever-moving target. And apparently there are 33 different definitions of what a species actually is. And no one can really decide for sure. I mean, the traditional explanation is that it suddenly is a species if there is no, if you can't interbreed with the other species. But so we have Neanderthals, which is supposedly a different species to us, but now there's evidence of interbreed with evidence of human interbreeding with the Denisovans, who are that they were found in a cave up in Russia. And we've even now got evidence of ghost populations, where we know they existed from the genetic data, but there are no living specimens. But they can work this out by analysing the DNA and doing all the coalescence. And there are two interventions with these ghost populations where there's no living specimen that's actually got that signature. So evolution is becoming very much more complicated than the simple model that we had before. And it's the popular analogy is the braided stream, where you've got this sort of stream, then you've got lines going back and forwards, and then you've got lines going across as the streams join together and then they break apart again. So it's a really exciting time, actually, and virtually every month there's some major new discovery that's coming out.
Yeah. Comment here from
Yeah, and because I'm just wondering where consciousness comes into it. Consciousness, you know, and actually, you know, primates are being in their mirror and somehow said, I know that's me. You know, do you know what I mean?
Yes,
that but consciousness comes into these, as you say, evolving species. It's up there somewhere.
I don't know. Well, some of the primate behaviour is very human, isn't it? And they've even been able to use tools and there's even on the David Attenborough, they even had that birds, I think, from the one episode where the birds were, they knew when to cross a major road, and the road was being, the cars were being used to break up their stones so they could get inside the shells. So I think there's a lot more to the birds.
There's probably a genetic basis to it, but we haven't figured it out yet. Like I said, we're still evolving. A comment from Gerard Corcoran.
Yes, I won't go back into the deep history, but if you look at some of the great inflection points in civilization, so you can clearly identify them. We're living in a modern age, and before there was the Iron Age, and the Bronze Age, the Age of Metals, and the Irish genetic genome was established in the Age of Metals, in the Bronze Age. That was a replacement of the previous wave, which were the farmers, which were the Neolithic people, which came before them. And the invention of agriculture allowed much larger populations, the development of cities, the development of civilization as we know it. And before that, we had the Mesolithic period and the glacial period. And so each of these waves brought its own characteristics higher densities of population. The interesting one from these isles was obviously, we had the various migrations of Ireland from the Vikings, the Normans, the planters, and so on and so forth. We had the Celtic intrusion, which came from Western Europe. We had the Belbeker folk, who we know came there about 4,000 years ago with their characteristic Belbeker. People asked, what was the Belbeker for? Well, it was originally for alcohol, right? And we were very good at these things. And then before those, the people who built Newgrange and these great monuments, they were from the Neolithic period. So there are different inflection points along history. And the great lactose tolerance, which we have in Ireland, the highest in the world, came from the, probably from these Bronze Age herders bringing that.
Do you have a question about that? Or does that answer your question? James, do you want to comment on that as well?
I've been troubled by this quite a bit, because one of my ancestors was Lewis Leakey, who discovered some of these Lucy-like things in Kenya 500 years ago. The way I reconcile it is that if we use the parallel of surnames daughtering out, it's not a phrase I like or I'm comfortable with, but surnames, lines of surnames do die out. And if we extend that parallel backwards, it would seem that all the Y DNA only goes back about 250,000 years. And we're not talking about billions, we're talking about iron toes. The other lines have died out, daughtered out, the Neanderthals have daughtered out. The stuff half a million years ago was daughtered out, and we're left with what we are. And everybody on the world, apparently, on the male side, shares an ancestor that's only about 150,000 years ago. This is a feature of Y DNA I'm talking about. On the mitochondrial side, I think it's over.
When we talk about Y DNA only going back 200,000 years, we're talking about human Y DNA, okay? Back to the time of modern, anatomically modern humans. But in actual fact, you can construct a complete Y DNA tree and you can add primates to it, you can add other species. So the Y, all the Y lines would actually coalesce sort of thousands or millions of years ago. Mitochondrial DNA actually takes us back 4 billion years to the very origins of life, because all human life that it is not archaea or bacteria actually has mitochondria.
The woman always has the last word.
Donna, while you're holding the... Sure.
I was going to add one thing about the Neanderthals, actually. We all carry about 286 variants that are Neanderthal variants in our own DNA. It's 286.
Was anybody surprised by the results that were published about Cheddar Man during the week? I mean, he's dark-skinned, he's blue eyes, and he comes from Wales. Does that remind you of Tom Jones?
And he likes cheese.
And he likes cheese. So,
well,
he was lactose intolerant. So, Donna, do you have any comments on that, or
no?
I just wonder. You're holding the microphone, so I thought you might do. Debbie, did you?
Well, it's been known for a long time that all these Western hunter-gatherers had dark skin. We had Lush Boer Man, we had Labrana Man, and they did a model of Labrana Man, and he had the dark skin and the same piercing blue eyes. What's different this time is that the technology has advanced, and there's a new forensics paper that came out last year, which has enabled them to be much more accurate in their predictions. There's also a big paper came out about skin colour in Africa, because a lot of the studies on skin colour have been done on Europeans, and hardly anyone has done sampling in Africa. And when you look at Africa, there's a whole diverse range of skin colours, from fair skin to dark skin, all across the continent.
My camera did a very good presentation on that in Houston at the Family Tree DNA conference last year. It was absolutely amazing to see the shades of different colour all across the African continent.
Yeah.
But also, what colour skin do the primates have?
They would be dark skinned as well.
No, if you shave the primates, they're white skin. So maybe the dark skin evolved somewhere.
Humans originally had light skin when we had lots of
hair
or whatever it could have been called at that time.
Whatever. And then it also fur.
If you shave a chimpanzee, though, it's going to be white.
Yeah.
That's amazing. I didn't
know. Yeah. Okie dokie. Well, I think on that note of shaving, I think we should call it a day for Genetic Genealogy Ireland 2018 in Belfast. Thanks. To everybody for attending, especially those of you who stayed for most of the lectures. And thanks also to our wonderful panel of experts.